In the first seven branches of his Eightfold Path, the Buddha describes the condition that must be fulfilled who desires to come to that right contemplation, which is the eighth and final branch. The fulfillment of these conditions entails the undertaking of a course of the most searching and comprehensive mortification. Mortification of intellect and will, craving and emotion, thought, speech, action, and finally, means of livelihood. Certain professions are more or less completely incompatible with the achievement of man's final end, and there are certain ways of making a living which do so much physical, and above all, so much moral, intellectual, and spiritual harm that even if they could be practiced in a non-attached spirit, which is generally impossible, they would still have to be eschewed by anyone dedicated to the task of liberating not only himself but others. The exponents of the perennial philosophy are not content to avoid and forbid the practice of criminal professions, such as brothel keeping, forgery, racketeering, and the like. They also avoid themselves and warn others against a number of ways of livelihood commonly regarded as legitimate. Thus, in many Buddhist societies, the manufacture of arms, the concoction of intoxicating liquors, and the wholesale of butcher's meat were not, as in contemporary Christendom, rewarded by wealth and political influence. They were deplored as businesses which, it was thought, made it particularly difficult for their practitioners and for other members of the communities in which they were practiced to achieve enlightenment and liberation. Similarly, in medieval Europe, Christians were forbidden to make a living by the taking of interest on money or by cornering the market. As Towne and others have shown, it was only after the Reformation that coupon clipping, usury and gambling in stocks and commodities became respectable and received ecclesiastical approval. For Quakers, soldiering was and is a form of wrong livelihood, war being, in their eyes, anti-Christian, not so much because it causes suffering as it because it propagates hatred, puts a premium on fraud and cruelty, infects whole societies with anger, fear, pride, and uncharitableness. Such passions eclipse the inner light, and therefore the wars by which they are aroused and intensified must be regarded, whatever their immediate political outcome, as crusades to make the world safe for spiritual darkness. It has been found, as a matter of experience, that it is dangerous to lay down detailed and inflexible rules for right livelihood. Dangerous because most people see no reason for being righteous overmuch and consequently respond to the imposition of too rigid a code for hypocrisy or open rebellion. In the Christian tradition, for example, a distinction is made between precepts, which are binding on all and sundry, and the counsels of perfection, binding only upon those who feel drawn towards a social renunciation of the world. The precepts include the ordinary moral code and the commandment to love God with all one's heart, strength, and mind, and one's neighbor as oneself. Some of these who make a serious effort to obey this last and greatest commandment find that they cannot do so wholeheartedly unless they follow the counsels and sever all connections with the world. Nevertheless, it is possible for men and women to achieve that perfection, which is deliverance into the unitive knowledge of God, without abandoning the married state and without selling all they have and giving the price to the poor. Effective poverty, possessing no money, is by no means always effective poverty, being indifferent to money. One may be poor, but desperately concerned with what money can buy, full of cravings, envy, and bitter self-pity. Another may have money, but no attachment to money or the things, powers, privileges that money can buy. Evangelical poverty is a combination of effective with effective poverty. But a genuine poverty of spirit is possible even in those who are not effectively poor. It will be seen, then, that the problems of right livelihood, insofar as they lie outside the jurisdiction of the common moral code, are strictly personal. The way in which any individual problem prevents itself and the nature of the appropriate solution depend on the degree of knowledge, moral sensibility, and spiritual insight achieved by the individual concerned. For this reason, no universally accepted rules can be formulated except in the most general terms. Here are my three treasures, says Lao Tzu. Guard and keep them. The first is pity. The second, frugality. The third, refusal to be foremost all things under heaven. And when Jesus is asked by a stranger to settle a dispute between himself and his brother over an inheritance, he refuses, since he does not know the circumstances, to be a judge in the case and merely utters a general warning against covetousness. We see, then, that a great man can be good, good enough even to aspire to unit of knowledge of the divine ground, provided that, while exercising power, he fulfills two conditions. First, he must deny himself all the personal advantages of power, and must practice the patience without which there cannot be love, either of man or of God. And second, he must realize that the accident of possessing temporal power does not give him his spiritual authority, which belongs only to those seers, living or dead, who have achieved a direct insight into the nature of things. A society in which the boss is mad enough to believe himself a prophet is a society doomed to destruction. A viable society is one in which those who have qualified themselves to see indicate the goals to be aimed at, while those whose business it is to rule respect the authority and listen to the advice of the seers. In theory, at least, all this was well understood in India, and until the Reformation in Europe, where, quote, no position was so high, but that it was subject to a spiritual superior in what concerned the conscience and the soul. Unfortunately, the churches tried to make the best of both worlds, to combine spiritual authority with temporal power, wielded either directly or at one remove from behind the throne. But spiritual authority can be exercised only by those who are perfectly disinterested and whose motives are therefore above suspicion. An ecclesiastical organization may call itself the mystical body of Christ, but if its prelates are slaveholders and the rulers of states, as they were in the past, or if the corporation is a large-scale capitalist, as is the case today, no titles, however honorific, can conceal the fact that, when it passes judgment, it does so as an interested party, with some political or economic axe to grind. True, in matters which do not directly concern the temporal powers of the corporation, individual churchmen can be, and have actually proven themselves, perfectly disinterested, consequently can possess and have possessed genuine spiritual authority. St. Philip Neri's is a case in point. Possessing absolutely no temporal power, yet he exercised a prodigious influence over 16th century Europe. But for that influence, it may be doubted whether the efforts of the Council of Trent to reform the Roman Church from within would have met with much success. In actual practice, how many great men have ever fulfilled, or are ever likely to fulfill, the conditions which alone render more innocuous to the ruler as well as to the ruled? Obviously very few. Except by saints, the problem of power is finally insoluble. But since genuine self-government is possible only in very small groups, societies on a national or supranational scale will always be ruled by oligarchical minorities. This means that the problem of power will always arise, and this, in turn, means that we cannot expect the large-scale societies of the future to be much better than were the societies of the past during the brief periods when they were at their best.